Welcome to this audio slide on the streams of corporate finance. My name is Manfred Frühwirth. I am professor of finance at WU Wien, which is Vienna University of Economics and Business. The purpose of this audio slide is to illustrate the structure of corporate finance and especially to show the differences between the various streams of corporate finance. First of all, let us define corporate finance. Corporate finance is the part of finance that deals with the financial decisions of companies. These can be decisions how to obtain financial funds and decisions how to use these funds. So corporate finance especially includes investment decisions and financing decisions. Investment decisions contain decisions whether or not to implement individual investment projects and whether or not to perform mergers and acquisitions. Financing decisions include the selection of the capital structure, the determination of the dividend policy, stock issues, and stock repurchases. As corporate finance is a field that is embedded in finance, the structure shown here for corporate finance is similar to that of finance, shown on another audio slide. Defining corporate finance with a very wide horizon, we have to distinguish between standard corporate finance and behavioral corporate finance. I will describe the difference between these two streams later. Standard corporate finance can be further subdivided into neoclassical corporate finance and neo-institutional corporate finance. The oldest stream of corporate finance is definitely neoclassical corporate finance. In neoclassical corporate finance, to facilitate things, you are working in a very simple and idealized model setting. Especially, you assume a perfect capital market. The assumption of a perfect capital market includes several assumptions. First, everybody has equal and free access to the capital market. So there are no capital market restrictions. Second, there are no transaction costs. Third, all securities are perfectly divisible. So, for instance, you can buy 2.47 stocks. Fourth, there is perfect competition on the capital market. Therefore, all market participants are so-called price takers. This means that nobody can influence the security prices with his orders. Another assumption within the assumption of a perfect capital market is the assumption that there are no taxes. The final assumption is that everybody has the same information. So there is full transparency on the capital market. This is called the homogeneous information assumption. The neoclassical models argue based on supply, demand, and market price. Due to the simplicity of the models, you can get very clear and often intuitive results. Therefore, the neoclassical stream of corporate finance is very powerful. The assumption of a perfect capital market enables the separation of investment decisions and financing decisions. To put it differently, in the neoclassical framework, investment decisions and financing decisions can be optimized independent of each other. For that purpose, you use as a benchmark the capital market. So investment decisions are evaluated relative to the capital market. And on the other side of the balance sheet, financing decisions are based on the capital market too. Several models rely on the assumption that investors can undo the corporate finance decisions of the managers by transactions on the perfect capital market. In this context, neoclassical corporate finance models often use no arbitrage proofs. Most of the basic models that have been derived in corporate finance are located within this group of models. This includes, for instance, the models set up by Franco Modigliani and Merton Miller that show, under rigid assumptions, the irrelevance of the capital structure and the irrelevance of the dividend policy. Also, the calculation of the cost of capital with the capital asset pricing model is derived within a neoclassical model setting. The problem with neoclassical finance, and therefore also with neoclassical corporate finance, is that the assumptions listed before are extremely unrealistic. For each of these assumptions, you could bring examples of violation in practice. To bring just one example, often in corporate practice, we have situations with asymmetric information. For instance, usually the managers of a firm are closer to the company than the shareholders. Therefore, they know better what is happening within the firm than the shareholders. And in reality, they can use this additional information to work rather in their own interest instead of the interest of their shareholders. The assumption of homogeneous information in neoclassical finance eliminates this opportunity from the model. In spite of these problems, the neoclassical corporate finance framework is very important because it builds a sound foundation on which to develop more elaborated corporate finance models. As the neoclassical assumptions strongly deviate from reality, researchers in finance in a first step added a second stream of corporate finance, namely neo-institutional corporate finance. In this stream, you relieve the assumption of a perfect capital market. Therefore, this stream includes corporate finance models that allow, for instance, transaction costs, taxes, or asymmetric information. Asymmetric information means that different parties have different levels of information. As a result, so-called principal-agent problems may occur. In this framework, the principal hires an agent to work for him. If the agent has more information than the principal, it may happen that the agent does not work in the interest of the principal, but rather in his own interest. Especially in corporate finance, there is a principal-agent relationship between the manager and the shareholder, where the shareholder is the principal and the manager is the agent. In this relationship, with asymmetric information, it may well be that the manager, equipped with more information, works in his own interest rather than in the interest of the shareholders. One example of such a principal-agent problem is the empire-building problem, where managers, for selfish reasons, enlarge the company beyond reasonable size and thereby destroy shareholder value. Neoclassical corporate finance and neo-institutional corporate finance together can be included under the umbrella term standard corporate finance. But with the extension from neoclassical corporate finance to standard corporate finance, the path of corporate finance was not finished yet. In the past decades, several researchers added a third stream, namely behavioral corporate finance. The difference between standard corporate finance and behavioral corporate finance can be described easily. In both streams of standard corporate finance, you assume that everybody is rational. This holds both for investors on the capital market, including parties that are supporting them, and for people within the companies. Technically, rationality means that people are maximizing their own expected utility. In contrast to standard corporate finance, in behavioral corporate finance, you allow for irrational behavior. Therefore, people are subject to biases like overconfidence, loss aversion, or regret, and they use heuristics like uncritically following the herd. This irrationality may occur, for instance, on the capital market or within the company. Irrationality on the capital market may include the irrationality of stockholders, bondholders, banks, or parties that are supporting the investors, like analysts or rating agencies. Irrationality within the firm may especially come from the managers. As a result, behavioral corporate finance can be interpreted as an interface between behavioral finance and standard corporate finance. Behavioral corporate finance analyzes the impact of psychological biases and heuristics on corporate finance decisions. For instance, behavioral corporate finance investigates how biases on the investor side cause a mispricing on the capital market, and this over- or undervaluation affects corporate finance decisions. Moreover, behavioral corporate finance analyzes the impact of biases on the manager's side on corporate financial decisions. Some examples of behavioral corporate finance issues are the impact of mispricing on the stock market created by two optimistic shareholders on the merger activity, or the impact of managerial overconfidence on the capital structure. Over the past decades, empirical research has produced substantial evidence that people act irrationally. Of course, this strongly raised the importance of behavioral corporate finance in the past years. Moreover, by integrating psychology into corporate finance, behavioral corporate finance is able to explain several puzzles that standard corporate finance cannot explain sufficiently. Examples of these puzzles are: why do, in practice, investment projects so often turn out to be less attractive than originally planned? Or why do managers react to losses by increasing the risk in the company? For instance, why do managers invest additional money into projects that already showed to go into the wrong direction? Other questions that are better understood in a behavioral corporate finance framework are: why are there waves of mergers and acquisitions? Or why do managers often use a very small debt ratio and thereby lose substantial tax advantages? Also, why do managers smooth dividends over the years? Or why do original investors often perform initial public offerings at a too low price? Or why do managers perform stock splits? These are just a few examples out of many that cannot be answered by standard corporate finance in a satisfactory way, but where behavioral corporate finance can strongly improve the understanding. Summing up, this audio slide gave an overview how to structure the field of corporate finance. As corporate finance is a subtopic of finance, the structure is very similar to the structure of finance. Altogether, there are three different streams of corporate finance: neoclassical corporate finance and neo-institutional corporate finance, both under the umbrella term standard corporate finance, as well as behavioral corporate finance. Moreover, I presented the differences between these three streams of corporate finance with respect to their assumptions. Thereby, we could see a consistent path that research in corporate finance has taken over the past decades. This path started with a very simplified and easy to handle world, namely neoclassical corporate finance, to generate the basic findings. Based on that, the next job was the fine-tuning. This required to include more and more sophistications to bring the models closer to reality. First, researchers added market imperfections. This was done by the models of neo-institutional corporate finance. In a second step, in a relatively recent extension, researchers added irrationality. This created the stream of behavioral corporate finance. Altogether, this wide horizon of corporate finance provides a very comprehensive toolkit that allows us to explain a lot of phenomena that we can observe in practical corporate finance. I hope you enjoyed this audio slide. Thank you very much for watching.